Hello, dear authors and invited guests. Welcome to Technical Session 2D. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. On behalf of World Earth for 2021 and Global Knowledge Research Foundation, it is my great pleasure to welcome you to the 5th World Conference on Smart Trends in System Security and Sustainability through Zoom. We are thankful to everyone on this platform to go along with us digitally for the conference in these unpredictable circumstances and making this conference more productive. Also, we wish everyone and their families a protected time, and we all will together pass this soon. We hope you will enjoy 2 days of the knowledgeable and interactive sessions. Just before we get started, I would like to introduce you all to the chair for this session, Mahesh Bundele, sir. He is the principal and director of Purnima College of Engineering, Jaipur, India. His areas of research interest are wearable and artificial intelligence, software-defined networking, and wireless sensor networks. He has organized and chaired many IEEE ACM and Springer international conferences and workshops, and delivered keynote addresses, and he has more than 100 publications to his credit. Welcome to you, sir.
Thank you.
Now it's all over to you, sir.
Okay, yes. So I think you can announce the paper authors. Okay. And you can start. Yes.
Now I'd like to start with our first presenter, Soumitra Vatsal. His paper title is Load Balancing Synchronized Burnout Oriented Approach for Safeguarding Cloud Services Sustainability.
Am I audible?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, I'm sharing my screen. Is my screen successfully shared?
Yes.
Good evening, everyone. Today, I am going to present my research paper titled Load Balancing Synchronized Brownout Oriented Approach for Safeguarding Cloud Services Sustainability. Well, this is the outline of the presentation. Okay, so proceeding further, cloud computing has embarked to be a global entity and as a paradigm with a difference to provide ubiquitous, convenient, on-demand, shared pool of configurable computing resources related with IT industry. The importance of cloud computing can be deciphered by the fact that it is reckoned amongst 5 technologies which would drive global economy of future. However, the number of users fluctuates and loads also exhibit labile nature. Therefore, corresponding cloud application related resource capacity requirements also exhibit dynamic nature. The unexpected gush of user demand, designated as flash crowds, poses an additional challenge since they expand request volume by 5 times. The aforesaid challenge of unexpected events can be duly addressed by application robustness to face the challenges of sudden flash crowd related load hike. The challenge is further enhanced due to increased data center failure incidences quite often, which otherwise would be exceptional to happen. Such unexpected incidences invoke an array of events which are expressed as infrastructure overload, translating into unresponsive services, resulting in dissatisfied end users and revenue loss ultimately. Therefore, cloud services related self-adaptation techniques such as brownout are of great benefit. The inspiration of brownout is drawn from blackout, which is done in emergency situations. Originally, the brownout scenario causes light bulbs to dim down in order to conserve energy. In cloud scenario, brownout basically deactivates certain microservices or application components only temporarily, by virtue of minimizing the amount of computations required for serving a request The brownout service empowers itself to adapt for maintaining response time close to a given set point. As a consequence, certain computations are specified as mandatory, like display of product information pertaining within e-commerce website, while certain computations are reckoned as optional, like products with similar qualitative value being recommended. It is noteworthy that providing an optional code-enabled service directly translates into a satisfied end user and thus incurring more revenue for service provider. The brownout service, however, faces a limiting challenge. If service is enabled by a single replica, which permits a single copy of application to be executed within a single virtual machine, this challenge can be suitably addressed by providing independent multiple copies pertaining to same application, known as multiple replicas, which cater same data to the user, and each replica is imbibed in a separate virtual machine. And further, each virtual machine can be hosted by different physical machines. This results in enhancement of brownout services. The load balancer is the component that determines which replica should address any specific end user request. Prime objective is to acquire a load balancing technique that is brownout compliant, along with awareness regarding each individual replica related self-adaptation mechanism. It incorporates a brownout compliant application, which is executed in synergism with multiple replicas. The load balancer offers an access to the cloud application architecture by involving clients to serve a request, then to either wait for a reply, otherwise to repeat the request at a distributed time interval. The load balancer receives every client request and passes it on to one of the N replicas. A replica so chosen in this process responds by reflecting it again back to load balancer, which is then passed on to the original client. The time required within the replica for execution of request is designated as response time. Each replica is enabled by a controller within it, which helps to monitor response time measurement periodically with respect to served requests and adjusts optional component related percentile regarding control period related response times. For establishing synergy with brownout paradigm, a replica response for requests is either partial, which include only mandatory contents for response, or it may be full when optional and mandatory both contents are included together. For addressing the challenge of synchronicity between load balancer and brownout compliant applications, the load balancer must function in coherence with brownout applications while receiving information about percentage of requests from replicas. This solution culminates in estimation of probability related execution of the optional components with respect to load balancer. A better user perceived stability is secured by stabilizing the response times by brownout framework, with load balancer functioning as an adjuvant. To achieve comparative performance analysis of different algorithms, different parameters are considered as indicators. The first one is a percentage regarding total number of optional enabled requests in accordance with the pertinent metric, where users exercise certain number of clicks in order to use the application. The load balancing techniques implemented are further titrated by certain other performance metrics too. For evaluating load balancing strategies, the brownout compliant applications are processed by Cloud Sim Simulator. An open loop client model upholds the assumption and negotiates a new client who initiates a certain number of unrelated requests, or it is dealt by a closed loop client model, where client invokes a request after receiving the response to continue for sending request one after another to the application. Both models are implemented in the simulator for evaluating applications of diverse nature, requiring certain number of clicks to be executed by the users. Load balancer receives the requests for diverting them towards different replicas. The per request basis is used to address simulation policies for tackling random, round robin, and shortest to first, which are independent of weights concept. The replica's related functioning is assessed by computational simulation for serving the request and to choose whether execution will be exercised with or without optional components activation. The simulator input called scenario supports insertion of new client and erases the existing one. It also monitors execution related turning on and off the replicas at specific time during the execution phase, along with changing the service times for each replica, taking both optional and mandatory components into consideration. It exhibits as change in resources backup for machine hosting the replica. It manages unpredictable changes at architecture level for monitoring the computational capability. For evaluation of changes pertaining to load balancing and replica execution scenarios, they offer a complete overview of the changes by virtue of simulations. The performance evaluation regarding different algorithms is adjusted with respect to new clients' arrival and disconnecting magnitude of existing clients. For experimental purpose, the first considered replica is taken to be the fastest one, with average execution time for mandatory and optional components both. Second replica considered has to be slightly slower than the previous one. Third and fourth replicas are the slowest ones. By executing the decreasing percentage of served optional content by means of algorithmic approach, EPBH procures best percentage overall, followed by VPBH, then COBLB, and finally SQL. The advantage of brownout aware strategy manifests as its ability to underutilize replicas. By the user's perspective, an application which exhibits quick response is preferred more than an application which delivers more features but with a sluggish response. It is obvious that optimization-based strategy enhances application-related capability for reacting fast towards changes and achieving high predictive values. Load balancing strategies extend their support to enhance functionalities of brownout compliant load applications. It is clearly evident that by considering the application adaptation capability for planning load balancing strategies results in predictable behavior along with performance maximization. The ever-expanding scope of cloud computing is inspirational to fulfill the dire need of cloud applications to withstand and negotiate the unexpected challenging events in the form of flash crowds and hardware failures or instant overloads. To alleviate these issues, it is indispensable to establish a synergism between load balancing solutions and self-adaptive applications of brownout. These two entities, load balancing and brownout compliant applications, are required to exhibit a fusion in such a manner that it could yield a mutually revamping support for one another. Heuristic-based improvised approach in this direction stands out as a convincing solution for addressing these issues. Innovative approaches regarding load balancing tactics and by configuring more adaptive applications could be instrumental for qualitative enhancement of the standards of networking in future. Thank you.
So any question from audience, anybody? Richa is there?
Yes, sir. Sir, no one is able to ask question. Only you can ask question.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, Mr. What is your name? Okay. I think you have prepared a theoretical paper rather than any experimental work. Did you do any experimental work in this regard?
Yes, sir. We did experimental work on cloud sim simulator.
What kind of experimentation you have done? What data?
Prima facie, this paper deals with an approach of load balancing and brownout mechanism. So what was done? Okay. So basically what was done was that the strategy taken was that we need to first go ahead and develop the model for a load balancer. And after developing the load balancer, any decision based on response times has to justify the efficiency of algorithms which are applied.
Can you show me on the slide if you have? You just read the contents.
Yes, sir. particularly I'm talking about this one. So this is the results of a simulation with four replicas, and clients are entering and leaving the system at different time instants. Left column shows the effective weights which were applied and the control variables on the right column. The first replica is shown in black solid line, second in the dashed line, third in the green dotted line, and fourth in the red dotted line. And the algorithms are ordered by decreasing percentage of optional content served, that is EPBH is best, followed by the others.
So is there any algorithm you have modified or developed any algorithm, or you have used existing algorithms?
Existing algorithms.
Okay, so you have compared different algorithms?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so which one you found as a better working, best working?
EPBH.
What is EPBH?
Okay, sir, EPBH is basically...
Yes,
sir, I'm coming to that with the results.
EPBH, you tell me the expansion.
Equality principle based heuristic, that is the complete thing. And it is a heuristic based strategy where near optimal solution is deciphered on the basis of all replicas, which should provide identical percentage of optional content. It is possible when control variables theta I are closest to each other. Sir, am I audible? Am I audible?
Yes, Soumit, you are audible. Okay. But I think as... Okay, thank you so much for presentation, Soumit. We can go ahead for our next presentation.
Thank you.
And our next presenter is Meenakshi M. Raikar. Our paper title is Network Size Slicing in Software Defined Network for Resource Optimization. Meenakshi, you can start now.
Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. I'll start. Yeah. We are presenting a paper on network slicing in software-defined networks, basically for resource optimization. Myself, Meenakshi Raikar, and my co-author, Meena SM, are presenting this. This is the outline of the paper. In our proposed work, basically, we are trying to classify the network services using the supervised learning model. Once we classify, we are using it for slicing the network based on the topology. What is the motivation? The internet users have a heterogeneous requirements. And this is posing a challenge to the service providers for catering to the network infrastructure needs to provide the different services. For example, the autonomous vehicles require low latency. Then the IoT slices, IoT applications, you require low bandwidth. In case we go for video streaming, then the high bandwidth is required. So for these different services, each of them are having a different characteristics. So it is essential to allocate the network resources for these services by traffic classification and by accelerated data processing. So now, what is network slicing? The slices are created on demand for independent management and control of the network resources, as we can see in the figure one. So we have a base, which is a physical network infrastructure. Then the slices of these physical network infrastructure is performed. For example, for IoT, it is low bandwidth. Then in case if you go for autonomous driving, then you have a low latency. And if you go for video streaming, then it is a high bandwidth. The utilization of the resources is efficient due to sharing the underlying physical infrastructure by forming different virtual networks. So the mutually isolated logical end-to-end network that runs on the same physical or the virtual network is network slicing. So now what are the objectives and our key contributions? The objective is to classify the network services using a supervised learning model depending on the traffic characteristics for optimal resource allocation. Then we develop a methodology for slicing the network based on the topology and the services provided to the user. What challenge we faced and what are the contributions? The challenge is dynamic creation of the slice, sharing of the resources, you have multiple tenant requirements, heterogeneity, and there is an end-to-end constraints. The key contribution here is integration of traffic classification and network partitioning is performed for optimization of the network resource utilizations. So this is a proposed system. The framework what we propose is integrating traffic classification using machine learning and network slicing. And basically we're using the SDN platform here. If you go with the right side of the figure, we have embedded the intelligence into the network. So here we have different components. First is the data collection. Then we process that data, which is in a form of trace files. We construct the model, the validation is performed. Then to the left hand side, we have the SDN architecture, that is the application plane, the control plane, and the data plane. So this is a proposed model that we want to say. So in implementing, we have performed topology slicing and we have performed traffic classification. The topology slicing is implemented using the FlowVisor controller. The switch communicates the open flow messages to the controller. Then the supervised learning model is used for classifying the video and the IoT traffic. Basically, we have used the Navibase and SVM and the nearest centroid as the supervised learning models for classification. When we go with the slicing, two main components are the flow management and the flow modification. The flow management is performed by using the match structure. The controllers coordinate the traffic of the network slices and how the flow modification is done. The flow table is modified for traffic forwarding by the controller based on the topology slice. The action in the flow table entry can be set as drop to enforce security policies within the network topology. So this is the experimental setup that we have performed. The simple topology that has been taken is shown in the figure. And we have created using the Mininet emulator and the POX controller is being used. The main command that we are using to control the flow tables is the FVCTL command, which is a part of the FlowVisor. Now, from this experimental setup, we have slice one, which is a high bandwidth, slice two, which is a low bandwidth application. And the same topology has been highlighted here with the IP addresses, the port numbers, the switch, what is the bandwidth for each of the links. The single link here has a bandwidth of 20 megabits per second. And the double line link have a bandwidth of 5 megabits per second. So here, basically, two slices are created for the network topology taken, slice one and slice two. Then we continue with the same topology in the next slide. How topology slicing is done. In slice one, the path between the host one and host three is represented by a single line, which shows a high bandwidth slicing for a video traffic. In slice two, the path between H2 and H4 is represented by a double line to indicate a bandwidth slicing of 5 megabits per second, and it is IoT slice. We have used the RTP protocol for streaming the video data between the host one and host three. And for IoT data, we have used the MQTT protocol to generate the non-video data traffic between the host H2 and H4. Then the traffic classification model is designed to predict whether the data traffic is a low bandwidth or whether it is a high bandwidth. The flow management in the flow tables. When video traffic is sent from host one to host three, the flow visor interprets the data packet and sends it to the controller one of slice one. Then the controller installs the flow by choosing the switch two to send the packet to the destination host. So the table one shows the contents of the switch two and the switch three. When I try to update the flow table, the OpenFlow protocol is used to modify the flow instances in order to slice the network. The flow table of the switch S1 and the switch S4 are updated by the controller on arrival of the network traffic. The table 2 depicts the contents of the flow table before and after communication with the controller by the switch S1. Now we want to have the
dear presenter, sorry for interrupt, you have a last 2 minutes, please conclude your presentation.
We go with the result analysis. The topology slicing performed in the experiment provides the isolation of slice one from slice two. The bandwidth utilization is represented in figure 4, and the classification of video and non-video traffic. So this is about the average packet length for the video and the non-video slices. The throughput we obtained for the non-video and the video slice. To conclude, the combination of a traffic classification and network slicing is presented for optimization of the network resources. The supervised learning model, SVM, Navy Base, and the nearest centroid are used to classify the network traffic. Network slicing concept is a solution to meet the stringent requirements of the business and the industry. Network slicing enables sharing of the physical network infrastructure by running different virtual networks on the same underlying network. The network topology is sliced with a high bandwidth slice and a low bandwidth slice. The network slicing technology enables the operators to efficiently utilize the infrastructure to meet the increasing demands of the internet users. So these are the references. Thank you. I am open for the questions.
So much, okay. Meenakshi.
Yeah. So I could not see complete representation, but I could see that you used SVM, Navy Bias, and which method performed best?
Yes, here the SVM is performing better when we go with classification.
Yes, the SVM naturally performs better best than all other general supervised algorithms.
Yeah.
So why are you comparing SVM with the Navy Bias and the third one? Actually, SVM, the principle itself is such that it is giving 100% accuracy in most of the cases.
Yeah. Actually, we wanted to compare. Yes, we wanted to compare with the other possible traffic classification that we could do. So these were the two that we could we have chosen.
Okay.
Maybe so, at the nearest center.
How much data you have considered about experimentation?
Experimentation, we have taken the video and the non-video slices.
So how many?
Huge data set. A sample data set which was generated by ourselves here in the laboratory was taken up for experimentation.
There must be some number, na? No. There's no number.
Yeah, we have taken a sample of 5 to 6 videos and the sample of IoT data for maybe in kilobytes.
So, and what was the architecture you used in SVM?
Actually, we have integrated both the this is the architecture that we propose. We try to combine these, the network architecture and the traffic classification architecture.
No, this is not the actual architecture of SVM.
Yeah.
This is not the
SVM classification architecture. This is what we try to implement, combining classification in networking.
It's okay.
Yeah.
But you have not explained anything about the architecture. What you which learning algorithm you use, which how many layers you used, all that. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you.
Next, Richa.
Next presenter is Sanket Tarambekar. His paper title is Decision Tree for Uncertain Numerical Data Using Bagging and Boosting. Dear author, you can start now.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. My paper ID is 303 and I'm just presenting the decision tree for the uncertain numeric data using bagging and boosting. Today, the outline of my presentation is introduction, literature review, proposed architecture, system architecture, technical specifications, results, and analysis. And after the conclusion and future directions for the and the references. Introduction. Data mining is an introducing method of consisting of different measures in the process of unravel the form. Data mining most significant element is vast volume. Data mining is a data source that contain first call records, data set database, retail chain data trends for accessing the credit risk, pathological records, science records analysis data, and data from the various music formats and market research documents. Process of data mining. Process of data mining involves the data cleaning, data integration, selection, transformation, mining, acknowledge, representation. Applications of data mining. Data mining is primarily used by the organizations with the instance consumer demands, retail, communications, financial, marketing company, determine the price, consumer preference, product posting, and the impact on the sales. Customer satisfaction and corporate profits. Retailers use the data mining to better targeted and identifying customers by the analyzing point.
I think you should go to actual work, its objectives and what you have done, rather than wasting time here.
Okay. I will start from the bagging. Bagging is the machine learning ensembling data algorithm. It is designed to improve the stability and the accuracy of the machine learning algorithm. These algorithms used in the statistical classification and the bagging also reduces the variance and helps to the avoid the overfitting. Boosting is an interactive TTL technique. It is adjust the weight of and the observation the based on the last classification. If an observation as was classified incorrectly, it tries to increase the weight of the this observation. Boosting in the general builds strongs the predictive models. Difference between bagging and boosting. After this decision tree, I have taken some data set. First I have applied the PDF function, probability density function, on the particular data set. After I am applying the boosting algorithm and bagging algorithm, after I am collecting the data to apply the decision tree. A decision tree is a flowchart like structure. In this, each internal node represent a test on a feature. For example, whether a coin flip comes up ahead or tails, each label decision taken after the computing all the features. Branches represent the to those class decision tree extensions. Obviously decision trees for decision trees introduced for the big data set. Incremental introduction. Proposed architecture. In this input data set, we are applying from the training data to the PDF function. From the PDF function, I am applying the bagging and boosting to the decision. After the bagging and boosting application, I am applying the decision tree and I will try to get the classified data from this. Proposed architecture. Step-by-step processing of the proposed work. First, processing of the trainable data set. Second one, on the data set, bagging and boosting techniques are implemented separately. For the bagging and boosting, various learning algorithms are used differently. Decision tree is the classifier used for bagging, and the ANA, artificial neural network, is the classifier utilized for the boosting. The finding obtained are then assembled using the MDT, meta decision tree. The final prediction is carried out based on the data obtained. System architecture. Technical specification. Uncertainty. Uncertainty is situation in which there is a sufficient information that is not possible to accurately reflected the current state of a data. Classification and the forecasting. Category. Forecast the categorical classes, labels, and classifies and use, acknowledge, correct, center.
Please do not define these parameters. Go to your experimental work. How did you implement bagging and boosting?
Okay. moreover organized by the bootstrap aggregating is a process that repeatedly tests by a data set corresponding to a uniform distribution of probability. Bagging increases the generalization error, that is the bagging giving benefits to decrease errors associated with the random training data variability. It element simple statements. Boosting is a reiterative approach utilized to adjust the disturbed for training, for example, adaptively, so that the base classifier focus on the for example that they are difficult to identify. Java development kit, and which enables a web-based project to be created. We are mean squared error, root mean squared error, and the accuracy by random force and random forest and ANN, artificial neural network. Some parameters I have given here. Mean absolute error is there 0.09%, and the ANN error is 0.1285. Mean squared error 0.09 and here 0.05. Accuracy is 91% and ANN in ANN 93%. Root mean squared error is 0.3 and ANN 0.2425. To improve the conclusion, to improve the categorization, consistency, and prediction system, data mining techniques are used successfully. It can also support medical professionals in their decision-making process. The data mining is a continuing method consisting of different steps in the process of the solve the design. The vast volume of data is the most significant element in a data mining. The method is examined and evaluated for the various factors such as mean absolute error, root mean squared error, relative absolute error, etc. Outcomes have demonstrated that the methods exceed current work in the terms of the number of instances classified. It also considers the parameters cited above as efficiency factors for the data set categorizations. As per the findings, it is clearly stated that for the certain kinds of data and the better results for the some ANN type classifiers. The decision tree classifier shows the best results. The ANN suggests the better outcomes in the data sets considered in the case of the experiments. Future directions. The decision tree for the new unknown numerical data using the bagging and boosting is used for the numerical data in the proposed system. Categorical data can be added in the future. Data mining using additional predictions attributes may also be used. Although various classification methods are commonly used for the disease predictions, the classifier for the decision tree is chosen for its simplicity and the accuracy. Decision supports system in internet for things of IoT data mining in the future. Better data training using the training based algorithms to help the needy in emergency can be created. Thank you, sir. I have lost my errors and connections. I'm not having the proper network.
Here. Are you able to hear me?
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
So still you could not clearly explain how the bagging and boosting has been implemented. You have shown result for random forest and ANN. What was the architecture used for ANN? Hello.
Hello.
Yes. What was the architecture used for ANN? Can you use negative numerical data?
No, sir, not.
What is the range you can use here?
From 0 to 1000 up to so on.
Why not 10,000, 1 lakh, 10 lakh?
I use that, but some error is there, but I will try to use that.
Do you know what is normalization, data normalization? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next.
Okay, our next presenter is A. Dhanush Kumar. His paper title is Abnormal Activity Detection Using Deep Learning. Dear author, you may please start now.
Hello.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Can I share my screen?
Yes, please.
Thank you. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. Before going into the topic, I would just like to thank the organizers for providing us the opportunity to present our work in the World S4 2021. So coming into the topic, in general, there is no such model which actually detects suspicious activities at the earliest. Instead, manpower is required to identify the activity, whether to say whether the activity is abnormal or normal. And in order to automate the surveillance system, I am Dhanush Kumar, along with my team members, came with the solution of automating the surveillance system with this particular title called as Abnormal Activity Detection Using Deep Learning. So we have built a system to automate the task of analyzing video surveillance. We'll analyze the video which is fed in the real time and identify any abnormal activities like violence, theft, robbing, burglary, vandalism, or any kind of activities, and say whether the given event is an abnormal activity or normal activity. And coming to the terminology, there are two sequences, there are two classes in our system, that is abnormal and the normal. Coming to the abnormal, so any kind of abnormal activity, there is some kind of change in from frame to frame. So there is some kind of drastic change from frame to frame. So here we can actually see from there are four different frames in the abnormal scenario, and there is drastic change from frame to frame, whereas coming to the normal, there is not much drastic change from frame to frame. So that particular disturbance will take us to tell whether the given frame or given video is an abnormal activity or the normal activity. So this is what the basic terminology, and these are the modules that we have used. That is GPU, and for training, because the data set is huge, and computer for coding, and the computer vision model as the videos and the images are used. And coming to the Keras module, Avenue data set, UCF crime data set, and C3A feature extraction, which is a pre-trained model. That is the second approach. We have gone for two approaches, and we'll be discussing that in our coming slides. So this is the block diagram of our first approach. This consisting of spatial encoder and spatial decoder, spatio-temporal encoder, spatio-temporal decoder. So it consisting of 3D convolutional encoder, 3D convolutional decoder, along with the bottleneck layer. The video is sent as an input to this particular 3D convolutional encoder. And from this 3D convolutional encoder, we'll be getting the frames. and the information is encoded. Thereby, it is sent to the bottleneck layer. In this bottleneck layer, it consisting of the temporal information, and it learns the frame-to-frame information, and it actually develops a sequence, and then it's sent to the 3D convolutional decoder, which actually reconstructs the frames. When we reconstruct the frame, there is some kind of disturbance in the original frame. That disturbance isn't much reconstructed. So we'll be getting some kind of reconstruction error. So depending on that particular reconstruction error, we'll be telling whether the given activity is an abnormal activity or the normal activity. That is what the basic approach behind this block diagram. So coming to the architecture, for input video sequence, as I've told, it will be in frames, that is video, every video will be consisting of some kind of frames, and it is sent into the convolutional layer. And this convolutional layer, there are two convolutional layers. These two convolutional layers together called as a spatial encoder, and there are three convolutional LSTM layers, these three together called as a temporal encoder and temporal decoder as well. And coming to the deconvolution, this is called as a spatial decoder. So convolutional layer will actually apply the filters to the frames, thereby generating the output in the matrix format. Then it is then sent to the convolutional LSTM. LSTM, it consisting of the feedback network. It actually learns the images from frames to frame. So it actually tells whether from the sequence to sequence, if there is any kind of disturbance or if there is any kind of noise created from the frame to frame, that actually is learned by this particular convolutional LSTM. And coming to the deconvolutional layer, after the model is learned with all the sequential information, then it is sent to the deconvolutional layer. Deconvolutional layer will actually reconstruct the frame from the learned information. So there is some kind of reconstruction error, as I've said earlier. So in that particular reconstruction part, the frames are again reconstructed. Then there will be, then by differencing or by subtracting the reconstruction error from the original frames, there will be some kind of value. So depending on that particular value, we'll be thresholding. And by that thresholding, we'll be telling whether the given event is an abnormal activity or the normal activity. So this is what the architecture of our first approach, that is spatio-temporal autoencoder. So this is the approach. And coming to the approach observations, after training our model with this particular autoencoder, of course, there is some kind of loss, that is 8% on an average, and the accuracy is 72%. That is the maximum accuracy by using this model. So we have evaluated why our accuracy is much less, and in order to improvise our accuracy, then we have added some more videos. So, and what we have learned is our Avenue dataset, which we have used, consisting of more of routine videos, and it has only some kind of suspicious activities, not all the suspicious activities, and also the dataset is much less. So. So our model is learning only with that particular videos and learning the weights of the same. So in order to improvise our accuracy, we have gone for another model, that is using the C3D pre-trained model. So here we can actually see the graph of our first model, first approach. So accuracy and loss isn't much increasing, and there is only minimal change. So coming to the second approach, that is C3D pre-trained model, using C3D pre-trained model. So what is C3D pre-trained model? C3D pre-trained model, that is convolutional 3D, abbreviation is that C3D, and it consisting of 16 different layers of various of convolutional layers and pooling layers, as well as fully connected layers along with the activation function softmax. So convolutional layer will actually applies the filters to the particular frames, and pooling layers will actually reduces the dimensions. We have multiple pooling techniques like average pooling, max pooling, and global max pooling, all these kind of poolings. And fully connected layers is like, from these fully connected layers only we can actually extract the information or extract the features, and the softmax function is the activation function which gives the relative probabilities of the different classes. Here we have two different probabilities. If we have more than two probabilities, or two or more than probabilities, softmax is the related activation function. And depending on the probability that the softmax activation function gives, then our model will be classifying the event as an abnormal or the normal. So coming to the approach of our second approach, we are taking abnormal videos and the normal videos as two different folders. And these two different folders, I mean, the videos from the two different folders as converted into 32 temporal segments. Each video is converted into 32 temporal segments. And each temporal segment is acting as an instance. So positive by consisting of an abnormal activity instances and negative by consisting of a normal activity instances. So each instance will be going through the C3D feature extraction. C3D feature extraction will extract the frame from these particular instances. And this frame and all the instances from the positive bag, all the instances from the negative bag will undergo this C3D feature extraction steps, and it will extract the features. And then it is sent to the classification network for training. And this classification network consisting of the dense layers and the dropout layers. And from this classification network, it can be any network. Classification network, then at the end, there will be softmax function, as I've told earlier. And the softmax function will give the relative probability. And from that particular probability, we'll be telling whether by mentioning some kind of threshold, say 0.75, for example, 0.7, if it is greater than 0.75, then our event will be predicted as an abnormal activity. If not, then our event will be predicted as an normal activity. So in that way, it depends on the developer to set that particular threshold by learning all kind of observations. So this is the approach and principle behind our second approach. So coming to the advantages by using this particular approach, it helps in automation in real time for deep surveillance, as I mentioned earlier, and also it can be used in order to monitor wide areas and also classify different kinds of videos. And these are the observations of our pre-trained model, that is using pre-trained model. So coming to the observation, so here we can actually see there is no spike in the anomaly score in the normal videos. So here this frame and this frame, there is not much change. So but whereas coming to the abnormal events, there is a change in the frames as well as change in the anomaly score. So this change in the anomaly score will actually tell to the model that given activity is an abnormal activity. So from this from that particular instance, the model will be telling the user that given video is an abnormal activity. So we can actually apply this in banks, ATM, and many more crowded areas. And also this actually can be applied in police department.
Dear presenter, you have last 2 minutes. Please conclude.
Yeah, sure. So this can be implemented in CCTV cameras, and also this can be automated and also makes man work easy. So coming to the conclusion, we have proposed the two deep learning approaches. One is autoencoder and one is using the C3D pre-trained model. So due to the lack of complexity in the first approach, the accuracy is much less, but due to increasing our complexity in the second approach, our accuracy is increased and our model is performing well. In order to validate the proposed approach, we can actually go for large data set, that is UCF crime data set, which consisting of real world anomalies, and all these pre-trained models will work better than the baseline models. So coming to our future work, we can actually implement this in our real time and in control room in order to make the police work easy. We can increase our data set, and we can implement this in railways, ports, ships, and also we can detect the cracks or damages also if we just improve our data set. And in future, we'll be considering the multiple object overlapping as well, and we'll be focusing more on other suspicious activities. and we'll be focusing more on specific activity detection rather than just two classes. We'll be focusing on other classes as well. So this is what our work. Thank you.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah. You said that due to increasing complexity, you are getting better results.
No, actually increasing complexity in the data set. Data set, if the data set consisting of just the normal videos, then there is no use of...
You have not given exact information, how much data, how many videos, what length, what kind of scenarios you have considered, especially because there can be many abnormal, as per your decisions, many abnormal cases can be normal also.
Yes, sir. Actually, I've mentioned that we have used two data sets, that is Avenue data set and
the details, which data, how many videos you have used for how much length, how many frames in each video.
Okay, sir. Actually, I've mentioned that we used two data sets, that is Avenue data set and UCF crime data set, and that is a general data set. I thought instead of focusing more on that, focusing more on the implementation will make my presentation worth.
No, you are not focused even on the implementation. Actually, you should give the design part, and you have just explained the architectural diagram of that. What the convolution layer do?
The convolution layer will actually applies the filters to the images or the frames, and then it gives the
output. What kind of parameters does it extract?
It extracts all kind of edges, color
information.
No, actually, it can actually extract the color information, but we have provided the grayscale images.
So in that case, what information actually is being processed from the images or the frames?
The image information, like say whether we do have cat image, then it actually cat edges, spikes, if there is any spikes in the images, or if there is any drastic change from frame to frame, in the frame, pixel to pixel information.
How that change will be detected from frame to frame? That's what I am asking. What kind of information it is collecting?
It will be collecting, pixel information will be collected by that particular convolutional layer.
So it will compare all pixel values of one frame to other frame?
No, only for one frame, it will compare the pixel to pixel information. CNN is, it is like,
okay, thank you. Hello. Yeah, thank you. Next.
Our next presenter is Shivang Ratnabarki. His paper title is A Novel Approach of Duplication on Indian Demographic Variation for Large Structured Data.
Hi. I'll just share my screen. Is it visible?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, thank you. All right. So a very good day to all of you. My name is Shivang Ratnabarki, and I will be presenting our topic, A Novel Approach of Deduplication on Indian Demographic Variation for Large Structured Data, along with my colleague Sonil Bide. We are the students of Dr. Krishnanandan Bhattacharya, our corresponding author, and we will be presenting on his behalf. So in the era of big data analysis, analysts face multiple challenges in large data sets pertaining to broadcasting information, data integrity, unique record error identification, as well as issues found during data ingestion, like redundancy, variations, and typological errors, along with missing fields and noisy data. So in order to achieve entity resolution and uniqueness, along with improving the quality of data, deduplication will be the solution. So deduplication is the process of removing duplicate records of the same real-world entity from structured data to ensure that there exists only unique values of a particular real-world entity in the data. In cases where when a specific data about a particular entity is stored, like medical records or government organizations, there might be cases of multiple instances of the same entity being ingested. So removing these duplicates becomes a necessary step for proper analysis of the data. India is a multilingual and multicultural country, and there are various ways and formats in which data of the same real world entity is represented across different parts of the country. Hence, there is a need to develop an India-centric model for handling the various forms and formats and doing the deduplication on Indian structured data. So some of the problems and variations found in Indian demographic scenario are mentioned below. So phonetic variation. So in cases like Muhammad, the spelling of the of the word changes drastically, and it can also be abbreviated frequently. These kind of situations also happen in cases of names of cities and states, like Ahmedabad can be have various different ways in which it can be written. There are also variations in parts of names where the order of the name may change, or in specific cases of females, the second half of the name may change completely. So in case of Rakesh Ajay Sharma, the name may be written as Sharma Rakesh Ajay in some places, or even Rakesh Sharma in some places. In case of Smita Harish Chandra, it can be written as Smita Vivek Tripathi, where Vivek Tripathi might be your husband and Harish Chandra might be your father. So such variations can be found. In case of North Indian nuances, the middle name may not be the father's name, but it may be an extension of the name, which may indicate the gender and or the community that the person belongs to. So Jai Singh Aluwalia over here, the name Singh represents the Sikh community as well as the male gender. And even you can see that we have mentioned some other variations that can be possible, like only Jai Aluwalia or Jai Singh Kumar Aluwalia. Even in cases like Hari Kumar, the Kumar is an extension of the word of the name Hari, which just signifies that that name is of a male person. Such cases are also available for females, like extensions like Rani or Kumari are added. For South Indian nuances, surnames are often absent, in which case the father's name may be the surname. These names are often long and are often abbreviated even in government documents. So you can see Bhuvneswari Krishnamurthy over here. It can be written as B. Krishnamurthy or Bhuvneswari K. Also, there are also cases like Amrita Sharma, a person from North India, when goes into Southern India, the pronunciation of the name dictates how it is written on government or documents. So Amrita Sharma will be pronounced as Amrutha Sharma or even Amrita Sharma in South India, and that will be reflected in the government documents. So this is a glimpse of the literature survey for deduplication on messy structured data, which is predominant in Indian cases. So the first one is Alias, which is a open source machine learning tool for deduplication. It calculates similarity between fields using edit distance and then classifies a match based on trained decision tree classifiers. This can only be used for domain specific fields and only works on small data sets. Next is Magellan. So Magellan is an entity matching tool which seeks to cover the entire pipeline of blocking, matching, extraction, etc. It has rule-based learning along with custom features for training and matching. So next is Febrile, which is it's one of the most popular ones. So Febrile is a tool built for entity resolutions specifically for the healthcare domain. It is based on the use of distance measures and classifiers like SVM and K-means classifiers. It has an ability to work only on name, address, date, and phone number fields. However, real-world data is quite noisy and cannot be compared with the help of only these fields. So that is one of the cons of Febrile that we found out in our literature survey. The last one is DeepMatcher, which is a deep learning-based technique which we are adopting in our system. So DeepMatcher uses RNN along with an attention mechanisms to implement a vector concatenation, which forms as an input to the classifier module. Using embedders and summarizers, matching records having various inconsistencies can be identified on large structured as well as noisy data. So the technology and the state of art which we're using is that DeepMatcher is a very highly customizable and scalable algorithm using which a model can be trained. We're having a word or character-based embedding along with an attribute summarization that can be achieved using aggregate functions, RNN, attention functions, or even a combination of these. So as Dpatcher uses these sophisticated methods, it aptly handles the aforementioned Indian scenarios, like the problems I mentioned in the earlier slides. So we have four main building blocks of our proposed approach: the block creation stage, the synthetic data creation stage, the prediction model for potential match and non-match using deep learning, and then determining deduplicable entries based on the threshold value. So for the proof of concept, we created a synthetic data of size 50,000 records, as the data we were considering was government data, which was private and has an issue of security and data sensitivity. So it was really hard to obtain, and hence we had to create a synthetic data. So this is a block diagram of our system. So we have CSV files containing structured data, which will be then passed as an input to the blocking phase. The blocking phase will have four subphases of gender-based filtering, phonetic encoding, similarity matching, and block generation, which will be explained in the further slides. After blocking, these blocks will be passed to the entity matching phase, which will then formulate a score using which we can then figure out whether two records are potential duplicates or non-matches. For further scope, these potential duplicates can then be sent to a graphical database for visualization sake, or they can even be sent to a linking linked graph or something like that. Now I'll pass on to Sonal, who will be explaining what our system basically does.
So as I mentioned earlier, first step of our process is blocking. Setting similar records based on some blocking called blocking. So by only comparing the records in one block, the number of comparisons can be reduced, and an efficient blocking method will help so that only potential duplicate records will be in one block. So considering a data set of 50,000 records, detailed comparison of all the fields of all the records would require 1.25 into 10 raised to 9 such comparisons, which is a lot. So blocking helps to reduce these by making sure that non-similar records based on the blocking key are never compared with each other. So in our method, phonetic encodings of name and address are considered as blocking key. So our blocking method leads to 99% reduction in actual record comparisons for the average cases. It handles phonetic variations using a custom phonetic algorithm, which we have created specially for Indian name gender variations. It handles variations in the structure of writing Indian names, which Ram had mentioned earlier. So the records taken from database are logged based on gender initially. Then phonetic encodings are created for name and address fields. And these are then compared using a modified cosine similarity function to generate the final blocks. So we found that traditional machine learning techniques are often less efficient in handling data variations and noisy data having inconsistencies. So deep learning techniques, due to the ability to define different hidden layers and having feedback loop structures, do not have such a drawback and can work on high-dimensional, non-linear, real-world noisy data. We have found a DeepMatcher, a deep learning architecture having a combination of RNN and attention-based mechanism suitable for this task. So a training set has been synthetically created, which consists of combination of anomalies and variations present in different fields, which we have found through extensive research and are similar to the real-world data. So DeepMatcher returns a match score between 0 and 1, where 0 is for exact match and 1 is for exact 0 is for exact non-match and 1 is for exact match. The records are in a tuple and considered potential duplicates only if the similarity score is above a threshold value. So after experimenting, we found 0.9 to be an appropriate threshold value. However, depending upon the data set, this threshold value can change. So we can see that T. Amin and Amin Prashad, though having names in different structures and some missing values are present, are given a high value due to the similarity in their remaining fields. Similar is the case with Amari, Malhotra, and Amari, where the names might be different, but data might be similar, even though having some missing field in one of these records. So we had to select a distance.
So sorry for interrupt. Dear presenter, you have last 2 minutes.
Yeah, okay. So we had to select a distance function that when combined with our phonetic function would give better results. Hence, we tested various string similarity functions and found that cosine similarity function gave a great F1 score and comparatively less amount of time. Earlier, we tested passing the fields having phonetic variations directly to DeepMatcher, but found that F1 score was relatively low for cases having missing fields as well as phonetic name variations. So by passing the encoded fields to DeepMatcher, we found that the F1 score approximately increased by 20%. And we can also see that average F1 score increased by using the encodings. So our system is a proof of concept to show the capabilities of deep learning strategies in the task of entity resolution. considering variations found in Indian data sets due to the cultural, linguistic, geographical differences, which may lead to various problems in the task of analysis. So data quality issues, schema variations, and volume and velocity of the data are taken into consideration while designing the system. A custom phonetic function and a modified cosine similarity function have been developed, catering to various variations found in the Indian data analysis. The outcome of research shows that deep learning approach is promising to solve several problems in the field of data integration, like automated data extraction, data training, and deduplication. The system can be further extended for other application domains like medical records, transactional data analysis, as well as customer databases for various e-commerce websites, and can suit to any domain that requires such a data analysis. Thank you. We are open for any questions.
Yes. So you are working on deduplication.
Yeah.
So how many records you have checked with your model?
We've checked a set of 50,000 records.
50,000?
Yes, sir. We used so the deep matcher model we used was able to work well with the GPU based system. So that provided us to have a very quick matching and deduplication phase.
What function you used for that phonetic matching and similarity matching and all that?
We initially tested with NYSWS and Cavasoon phonetic function as well as Soundex, but we found that these weren't suitable for Indian names. So we went through all the Indian names and found the phonetic variations found in names in different parts of India, and we created our own phonetic function based on the rules which we found in these names. And for distance function, we have used a cosine function along with a modification for South Indian names.
So, and if I give you non-structured data, what will happen?
Unstructured data currently won't work with our system. We'll have to tweak the inner workings of the system to ensure that it works with unstructured data. The phase of where reading from a paragraph and converting it into tokens is not available in our system right now, but that is something which is a future scope of our system.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
And our next presenter is
Hello. Hello.
Hello, Mansi. You may please start your presentation.
Okay. Yeah, I'll share my screen. So good afternoon, everyone. We paper ID 202. We are here to present our paper on the title Blockchain-Based Decentralized Electronic Voting System. Myself, Mansi Dabriwal, and my other members are Shrey Kesana, Mahima Pawar, Raj Shati, and Sachin Sir. Our domain is blockchain. So these are the few contents which we will be looking forward. First is problem statement. Being a part of the largest democracy, one of the biggest challenges for us is to choose our government. This is an unequivocal challenge among most of the highly educated countrymen, as these people are staying far away from their homes and won't be able to cast their votes. These elections range from community elections to municipality elections, all the way to the elections of choosing the prime minister of our country. Also, during these times, trying times of going through the pandemic, nobody is going to be able to vote through the conventional election system. And how long do we delay that? So here are we trying to propose a solution to the problem through our paper, e-voting system, and we have used blockchain technology for this. So here are the key objectives that we have tried to achieve in this paper. As it is an online system, there is always a question of tampering. Through blockchain, we can assure no tampering of votes, as blockchain is immutable. Blockchain is decentralized, so there will be no bottlenecks in the system, and the system can run 24/7. Next is that voters can vote from a distant places, thus saving time for voters as well as saving the cost. And every voter can vote and no vote is wasted. Now let's move ahead to the literature survey.
So this paper is based on the studies conducted by Mrs. Harshavi Patil et al. In their paper, and it speaks about a study of the traditional e-voting system and also expresses the potential of blockchain and its usefulness in e-voting. Studies conducted by Ms. Reefa Hanipatunisa et al. In their paper majorly focuses on how the blockchain works and how blocks are added during e-voting. Additionally, studies conducted by Mr. Hari K. Prasad in their paper discuss the general study of how EVM machines are built, its structure, and talks about certain experiments which were conducted which prove how EVM can also be tampered. Also, studies conducted by Mr. Ahmed Ben Ayed in his paper speaks about the e-voting systems in different countries and discusses how the drawbacks of these systems can be overcome using a blockchain-based e-voting system. Similarly, based on these papers, this paper discusses blockchain, the security issues of the traditional e-voting system, and how e-voting using blockchain ensures an efficient approach of conducting elections. In this paper, we have proposed the system which consists of the following phases.
So the first phase is the authentication phase. Any potential voter can securely log in using his email and password. After successful login, the user will receive a secret token in their registered email ID. Once the secret 16-character secret token is verified, the voter will be directed to the voter's UI. Next is the casting vote phase. Voters can cast their vote once the elections are started by the authority, by choosing one of the candidates from a list of candidates displayed to the voters. Next is the encrypting vote phase. After the successful casting, the system will generate an input that contains voters' information as well as the hash of the previous block. This way, each input will be unique and ensures that the encrypted output will be unique as well. The encrypted information will be recorded in the block header of each vote cast. This method will ensure the uniqueness of both input and output. Next is adding block. After block is created and depending on the candidate selected, the information is recorded in the corresponding blockchain. Each block gets linked to the previously cast vote. Last is the display result. Voters don't have to wait for days and weeks for the results of the election. Once the election period is over, the results will be made visible to the voters in their dashboard.
Certain properties must be held by the system in order for it to be deemed secure for e-voting, like fairness. That is, results of the election should not be made public before the deadline of the election is over. Authentication, that is, to ensure that only those voters will be allowed to vote who are eligible and gives them the right to vote only once. Privacy, that is, to ensure that the identity of the individual voter is not revealed to anyone. The solution proposed in this paper is successfully able to inculcate all these properties. Displaying the election results after the election ensures fairness. The OTP authentication mechanism ensures authentication and use of blockchain, and storing the data in encrypted format ensures that the identity of the individual voter is not revealed to anyone. The evaluation is done on the basis of verification of the voters, voting only once per voter, vote converting into blockchain transactions, adding candidates, standing for the elections, and displaying the results after the election is over.
Next is conclusion and future work. So to conclude, we have discussed maintaining the anonymity of the voter and tampering of the votes are some of the fundamental issues for an online e-voting system. And implementing the e-voting system through centralized systems might be inclined to the tampering of votes. So with the virtue of blockchain, we have proposed a system which is decentralized and assures no tampering of votes. Authentication of voters is done through the secret token of 16 characters sent to the registered email ID of the voter, and the token is valid for just next 5 minutes. So ensuring only valid voters can cast their votes. And with the help of the vote bit, we make sure that every voter can cast their vote only once. Additionally, the system can be made more robust by doing authentication of voters through biometric as well as the webcams. So our system can ensure that voters can cast their votes from a distance, distant places in a completely secure manner, thus providing a better alternative of conducting the elections in which any situation which requires gathering of people at any given place will be avoided, which will be proved the most useful in the near future given the current pandemic scenario. These are some of the references. Thank you. And we are open for the questions.
So you have for how many data you have used tested your system now?
So this was used for departmental elections. So
how many voters?
So it was majorly used for teachers. So I am like on an average, I guess around 100 voters were there. Yeah.
So lapses, you have already told that A can vote for B also if knows email ID and password.
No. So we have used the OTP authentication mechanism.
Even in that case, it can happen.
For now we have used only the secret token for the authentication purpose, and we will be increasing the authentication process in the future scope.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Richa, is there anybody else?
No, sir, all completed.
Okay, good.
Now we have completed all our participant presentations. Thank you all authors for the excellent presentation in this session. And I sincerely thank you all our participants for being a part of this international conference. I hope this session was informative enough. All the presentation would be getting their digital certificates through email within 2 working days. Further, all the papers have already forwarded to the Springer. The publication will be live within 5 to 6 months. Kindly cooperate with the team of World Ace Sport 2021. I also thank our session chair, Mahesh Gundele, sir, for chairing the session. I request to my team to display certificate on the screen, a token of appreciation to the chair on behalf of team World Ace Sport 2021 and Global Knowledge Research Foundation. Thank you for your valuable presence, sir.
Thank you.
And now, dear all, I kindly request all to on the camera for a quick snapshot of the virtual conference.
I think my camera is on, but okay. You have muted it. My camera is muted from your side.
Yes, sir.
Just a minute.
Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Stay safe and take care.